Equities rallied and the US dollar eased yesterday, but the fundamental news weren't necessarily supportive of a sustainable improvement in the risk appetite, nor a reason to believe that the Federal Reserve would soften its policy stance. So welcome, this is Swissquote's daily market talk. So the US equity markets rallied yesterday after taking over a positive session from the Europeans, although be careful because the retail sales data in the US didn't necessarily go in the way of slower inflation, and Jerome Powell didn't say things that investors would normally like to hear, because first the US retail sales data in the US came in better than expected. The retail sales in the US grew more than 8% on a yearly basis in April. That was more than around 7.5% printed a month earlier, and that's good news per se, because that means that the Americans continue spending despite the tighter economic conditions out there, so the economy is pretty much strong. But it could also mean that they perhaps use more credit cards to keep their purchasing power intact in the rising inflation environment, which is not exactly healthy for the future. And more importantly, the strong spending from people means that the impact on inflation is more limited than we may think. So that's the thing, right? Our inflation problem mostly comes from the supply side problems, especially from the soaring energy prices and the soaring food prices as a result of the pandemic hit on the supply chains and the war in Ukraine, for example. But the monetary tools that we have in hand are intended to control the demand side and not the supply side, and bring inflation by cooling down the demand. So if that doesn't work well or efficiently, it will take the Federal Reserve a bit more rate hikes to tame this multi-decade high inflation in the US. So it is not perfectly good news. So it's no surprise Jerome Powell said that the Fed is resolved to curb inflation, even if it means pushing the interest rates into restrictive territory. Boom. So he actually said if bringing down inflation involves moving past broadly understood levels of neutral, we won't hesitate to do that. So that is a solid declaration against inflation, which interestingly didn't hit the investor appetite yesterday though, because we saw Nasdaq, which normally doesn't like hawkish comments on the rates, rally more than 2.5% yesterday as the S&P 500 rebounded some 2%. The US dollar, on the other hand, eased from a 20-year high. As such, we saw the euro dollar rebound past the 105 level yesterday, and the Eurozone's final inflation data is due today and should confirm a rise to 7.5% in April. So that is an eye-watering number for Europe, which should keep the European Central Bank hawks and the euro bulls quite alert and maybe help the single currency consolidate its latest gains against the US dollar. The pound dollar is also in a better shape since last week, but what drives the sterling's actual strength is not a more hawkish Bank of England, but rather a broadly softer US dollar. The data showed this morning that inflation in Britain advanced to 9% in April. That was just a touch lower than expectations, but a number that will only get the Bank of England to tighten its policy still, while warning that recession could also be the reality of Britain before this year ends. Anyway, overall in the FX markets, we were anyway expecting to see a broad-based drawback in the US dollar following such a strong rally to the 20-year high. So it is no surprise really that there is some easing at the current levels, but the US 10-year yield is steady around the 3% mark, and it is poised to move higher parallel to the expectations of solid rate hikes in the US in the coming FOMC meeting. So that and the positive divergence of the Fed outlook compared to the other central banks should actually prevent the US dollar from falling too much from the actual levels. I mean, it is sure thing that other central banks like the Bank of England and European Central Bank are also tightening their purse strings or thinking about it, but they sound a bit timider when it comes to the timing and the intended sizes of the eventual moves. That's especially true for the ECB, and they sound much less worried about inflation than Jerome Powell is. They are more worried about a potential recession. And speaking of the interest rates, while gold is up and down around the $1,800 level, in one hand, the positive pressure on the US yields weigh on appetite for the non-interest-bearing gold. On the other hand, the high volatility of the moment and the looming uncertainties support some safe haven inflows toward the safe haven yellow metal. But the truth is that gold is back to the levels it was trading before the Ukrainian war. It is below its 200-day moving average today, which now acts as a resistance to any positive attempt, and it is also preparing to test the long-term triangle base to the downside, of course, which, if broken, should confirm a further and a stronger negative outlook moving forward for the gold. Finally, crude oil spiked about $115 per barrel yesterday, but bumped into top sellers above this level. As we were talking in the previous weeks, well, there is certainly a solid support building into the $120 per barrel mark, which will be hard to clear as the rising energy prices, especially at these high levels, will have a curbing effect on demand and automatically cool down the oil rally. So no worries, guys. We are probably not rich enough to keep this rally going to the $200 per barrel level, as many were pointing earlier this year, remember? But on the other hand, on the downside, it will also be hard to pull the prices below the $100 per barrel psychological mark, as the reality on the field is that supply grows structurally less than the historically high demand right now. And that's obviously partly due to the pandemic, partly due to the war, and partly due to a lower investment in facilities as the capital now flows towards the greener energy sources. But at the end of the day, the result is the same, right? The relatively lower supply is what keeps energy prices sustained at the current levels right now. Now, let's also talk about the individual stocks, as we had a couple of interesting news that are worth having a look at. So I will start with Paramount, which actually rallied 15% at yesterday's trading session after Berkshire Hathaway disclosed it took $2.6 billion stake in it. Man, Warren Buffett is really active these days in the markets, and these news actually have been a breath of fresh air for the Paramount stock, which has been actually battered along with the other streaming services like Netflix, for example, on concerns that the end of the COVID pandemic and the rising competition within the streaming sector would hit their businesses. But even Netflix, which announced to let go of 150 employees, rallied more than 2% yesterday thanks to a global spike in risk appetite, which, however, may not last long as the earnings from the US retailers are not telling a beautiful story. It's actually telling a mixed story. Walmart, for example, reported an almost 25% drop in its net revenue last quarter due to rising fuel and food costs, and it just missed earnings estimates. So they sold more stuff actually in US dollar terms, but not more in terms of articles. So people just spend more money to buy the same things or maybe less items due to the higher inflation, but they also use more credit cards to maintain their purchasing power faced with such a big price swings and price swings to the upside, obviously. Home Depot, on the other hand, reported its strongest quarterly earnings. Well, the company said that the transactions fell 8.2% last quarter, but that they still raised their full year outlook as shoppers trade up to premium products, writes the CNBC's report. Walmart shares dived more than 11% yesterday. It was the worst one-day drop since 1987, while Home Depot gained some 1.70%. So the results were quite mixed, as I said, but Wells Fargo joined the other big banks warning of an imminent recession in the US, and analysts at Wells Fargo said, while the risk of economic growth contraction or recession has risen steadily through the first months of this year, they are now beginning to cross over a probability level that actually makes recession a base case scenario for the end of this year and the beginning of the next year. So it is quite a complicated way to say that they actually expect the US economy to slip into recession by the end of this year or the beginning of next year. So this is all for today. I'm İpek Özkardeşkaya and thank you for joining me. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and it has been insightful to you. So please do not hesitate to leave your comments, your reactions and your questions below as usual. And follow us on Instagram, on Twitter and on LinkedIn for regular market updates. And subscribe, of course, to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again tomorrow, and until then, good day trading.